Hi, and welcome to Chapter 3, Cells, the Living Unit. So first, here's an actual photograph of Robert Hooke, Schleiden-Schwann, and Virchow. Just kidding. But they were scientists that did help develop the cell theory. And they used microscopes to do this a long time ago. And the cell theory just says basically that the cell is the basic structural unit of life. All cells come from pre-existing cells. We're not made from computers yet. And all living organisms are composed of cells. It may be one cell, or it may be like humans, which are made of trillions of cells. Cells, as we mentioned, are the smallest living unit, and there are over 200 types. And their shape reflects their function. Anytime I say this in lecture, just go ahead and yawn. I know, I'm going to say it 100 times. As we mentioned in class, 96% of our body is made of carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen, and oxygen. There are three main parts of the cell. The cell membrane is also known as the plasma membrane. Cytoplasm is the fluid kind of compartment inside, and the nucleus. And of course, we have other organelles that we will discuss in more detail in just a little bit. Let's start with the plasma membrane. It's a phospholipid, meaning it's made of phospholipid bilayer. It's got two layers. One, two. The little blue balls are hydrophilic heads, meaning water-loving. The tails on the inside are hydrophobic, and they're more water-resistant. The membrane is flexible, so you'll hear it referred to as the fluid mosaic model. And if you need more of an example of this, or you want to visualize it a little better, this is a picture of the cell, and we're just taking a section of that. The membrane actually wraps around the whole cell. The cell membrane is selectively permeable. It only allows certain substances to move in and out of the cell. And we'll talk about how that happens with membrane transport in just a little bit. The membrane, I did not mention, separates two compartments, the intracellular environment and the extracellular environment. The fluid in the intracellular environment is called intracellular fluid, and extracellular fluid is outside of the cell. And I will sometimes abbreviate these as ICF and ECF. You may have also noted proteins, those pink big proteins that are in the plasma membrane. They are classified depending on how they run through the membrane. These are integral proteins that are all the way through or integrated into the membrane. Peripheral proteins are kind of connected to those, and they're not embedded in the membrane itself. Proteins are going to act as receptors and also passageways or channels from the inside to the outside or vice versa within the cell. The glycocalyx is another type of method for cells to recognize each other, and it's a carbohydrate or sugar-rich coating on the outside of cells, similar to the function of proteins that we just talked about. Cells also communicate through different junctions. Tight junctions are a really tight communication or makeup between cells. So adjacent cells, cells that are next to each other, are really tightly kind of fused together. This allows them to communicate really quickly. Desmosomes are also tight junction, but a little bit more loose than tight junctions. And they're also known as anchoring junctions. They look similar to kind of like a zipper. And gap junctions are gapped, and they allow kind of a tunnel between cells so that fluid can move quickly from one cell to the next. Just to show you, we've got a tight junction here, desmosome here. You can see it's a little bit looser. And then over here you can see these little channels, very small, in the gap junction where fluid can move between adjacent cells. And you'll see examples of these in different types of systems while we go through anatomy. So membrane transport is, as we mentioned, a selective process. Certain molecules get in and out, and it's passive or active. Passive meaning no energy is required. Active meaning that we do need energy, or ATP. The passive processes include diffusion, facilitated diffusion, and osmosis. And diffusion is movement of particles from an area of higher concentration, meaning they were more concentrated in that area, and they go into a less concentrated area. This is sped up based on, or slowed down based on, the size of those particles, the temperature, and the gradient. And gradient just means the difference in concentration between two areas. If it's larger, then movement is going to occur faster. Facilitated diffusion means that something is present to help these particles move. So it's either going to be a carrier of some sort or a channel. And this is more selective because those proteins that we saw typically are going to help with this, and they are only going to allow certain size particles through, as an example. Osmosis is the diffusion of water, and you can see in this picture, water has moved over to the right side because initially this side was more concentrated. There was more solute per water or solvent in this region, and so water had to go over to kind of balance things out so that the proportion on each side was equal and the gradient was equal on both sides. When this happens, the tone of cells will change, and if you've seen examples of cells bursting or shriveling up, you have seen this before. But solution can change the shape of cells. ISO means same. And so same tone means that there's going to be the same tone, on either side of the extracellular and intracellular environment. So for example, if you put this cell into a certain solution and the concentration is equal on both sides. If there is a hypertonic situation, hyper means higher. And so there's going to be a higher concentration of solute in the solvent, typically water, but it could be other things. And so this is a hypertonic solution. So water would want to leave the cell in order to balance out the ratio on either side. Hypotonic solutions are more diluted, and so there's going to be more solvent and less solute. Active processes, again, require ATP. They go against the concentration gradient, so they typically go from a lower concentration to a higher concentration. And this includes vesicular transport, which is transport of materials in little bubbles called vesicles. Also phagocytosis and pinocytosis, which means cell eating and cell drinking. And those are examples of endocytosis. As far as the cytoplasm, that's a material within the cell. The biggest part is cytosol, which is the fluid portion where cell activities occur. The cytoskeleton, we'll talk about later, are anchoring kind of units of the cell that help with structure and movement. Organelles have a specific function. And finally, inclusions are specific to different systems and may or may not be present. So the cytoplasm, kind of boring. You can just see cytoplasm, kind of the fluid portion. The nucleus is the largest organelle. It's the biosynthetic center of the cell. It's surrounded by a nuclear envelope with pores. Those are those little dark holes that you see. And they have a nucleolus. This contains genetic material. We'll talk about it at the end. Mitochondria are these little bean-shaped organelles that you can see. There's many of them in most cells, and they're the powerhouse of a cell. They make energy, or ATP. They have inward folds, and those are called cristae, and there's a gel-like matrix within the mitochondria. Mitochondria also have their own DNA and RNA and ribosomes, so they can reproduce themselves. Ribosomes are these little tiny dots that you see all along on what's called the rough endoplasmic reticulum. This is the site of protein synthesis, where proteins are made in ribosomes. Some of them float freely, but most of the time you'll see them attached to rough endoplasmic reticulum. Smooth endoplasmic reticulum is continuous with the rough ER. I'm going to call it ER. That's a lot easier to say. Smooth ER makes lipids or fats and also helps out with detoxification reactions. The rough endoplasmic reticulum is going to modify or change the proteins that are made in the ribosomes. So you can see that it's studded with those little ribosomes. The ER is a folded mass of little sacs, membrane, and the rough ER itself helps to make membranes or manufacture membranes. The Golgi apparatus is another example of flattened little membrane kind of sacs, and it's the post office of the cell. It's going to modify and sort material that comes in, and so I call it the post office of the cell. Your book calls it the traffic director of the cell. Something to note here is that lysosomes will bud off of the Golgi apparatus. And lysosomes, lyse, L-Y-S, is to destroy or break down. And so these contain enzymes that break down other other things that may have been packaged there, like lipids or proteins. Peroxisomes, however, have a similar function but come from the ER. They bud off of the ER, not like lysosomes, which come from the Golgi, but they also contain powerful enzymes that break things down. Okay, another picture of lysosomes there. All right, the cytoskeleton includes rods within the cytosol and also proteins. Microfilaments are the smallest of the cytoskeleton, and these include actin and myosin, which we will see when we talk about muscle contraction. Intermediate, or kind of the medium-sized rods, are woven ropes, which are tough, and they help the cell to maintain a stable structure. And then microtubules include centrosomes, and they are more dynamic. They can move, and they are the largest in diameter. So to show you what I'm talking about, at the center of a cell here, you can see centrosomes. So these are microtubules that are going to help out with cell structure. Centrioles are found at the base of cilia and flagella. And just to show you, cilia are little hair-like structures that propel substances past the cell. So they don't move the cell itself, but they move stuff past it, usually mucus. They're usually found with goblet cells, and those produce mucus. So cilia are going to kind of beat that mucus along past the cell. A flagella, in this picture you can see the little centriole at the base of the flagella, again a microtubule, and it is something that propels a sperm. All right, the nucleus we've talked about, some cells, interestingly enough, do not have a nucleus. Red blood cells, for example, when they mature, they lose their nucleus. But some cells have many, and we'll give you some examples in a few weeks. It is the largest organelle, and we've seen it once, so I won't spend a lot of time on it now. But it does contain chromatin, which is what kind of condenses to form chromosomes when a cell divides through mitosis. Chromatin is about a third of it is DNA, and then about the other two-thirds or so are proteins. The cell cycle is interphase, prophase, metaphase, anaphase, and telophase. And most of the slides that you will see, or most of the cells that you see in slides, are going to be in interphase, because it takes up the most time. If you look at this little pie chart, interphase is this whole part. And then finally, you've got mitosis, where the cell actually divides and splits off into two daughter cells. So most of the time, we see these in onion slides. These are onion cells, and most of them are in interphase. And again, this is just a cartoon diagram. Okay, prophase, DNA condenses now, so you can see chromosomes. All right, so here it is in an onion slide. We've got prophase down here, where you can actually see those chromosomes kind of condense, and they're kind of scattered all over the place. The next stage is metaphase. What happens is those chromosomes come and line up in the middle. Meta means middle. They line up along the middle in the metaphase plate, or the central plate. Alright, there's metaphase. Metaphase. You can kind of see them all lined up. The next phase is anaphase, and the two different sets of chromosomes are pulled in opposite direction towards opposite poles. And this is what it looks like in an onion. You can see these two sets being pulled towards opposite directions. Finally, telophase, you start to see a little furrow, a cleavage furrow, right down the middle that helps to divide it, the one cell, into two daughter cells that are identical. All right, and this is a nice picture. You can actually make out that cleavage furrow, and that onion cell has become two daughter cells. There's a video, if you would like to watch it, I will play it. We come back to it in 1 second for those who don't want to watch it. Extracellular materials, just so you know, is anything that's not within a cell in the body. This includes interstitial fluid, plasma, cerebrospinal fluid, and other bodily fluids. The extracellular matrix is found in connective tissue. You'll hear me say that. And it's just kind of an extracellular, not within a cell, but it's a part of tissue. It's kind of like cell glue that holds things together. So here is the video for those of you who are interested. And there's your centromere again. Okay, so that's available through a link on the PowerPoint, and it should be in Blackboard. And that's it for Chapter 3. If you have questions, email me. If you need more resources, email me, and we will have a quiz at the beginning of next class. And I hope you guys have a great holiday.